10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Growing Bolder, what's next?
Hi, everybody. I'm Mark Middleton, and welcome back to What's Next. I hope you guys have had a great week. It has been a very busy but productive week here. But I always look forward to Fridays because I am always inspired by our guest here on What's Next. And it would be a gross understatement to say that I am inspired by Mike Leonard. Coming up in just a few minutes, we're going to chat live with Mike from his home in suburban Chicago. For my money, he is one of the greatest storytellers in the history of broadcast journalism, an Emmy Award-winning correspondent for the Today Show for 32 years, a filmmaker, a New York Times best-selling author. Mike has joined Growing Bolder to continue his quest to share stories of common humanity. And speaking of sharing important messages, the new edition of Growing Bolder magazine is now in the mail. It's headed to subscribers worldwide. I love this magazine. And I think you guys will too.
This is the world we live in. These are the days to come, and it is up to us to seize them all. We are the ones we've been waiting for. Ordinary people living extraordinary lives. These are the pages you'll find them on, and this is the magazine. Growing Bolder, in your mailbox, on your screen. Subscribe now at growingbolder.com/magazine.
Well, before I introduce Mike, there are a couple of things that you should know. He was the first network correspondent in television to research, produce, write, shoot, and edit his own stories. He really is the pioneer of a model of broadcast journalism that has changed the industry worldwide. In fact, Rick Kogan of the Chicago Times said, quote, "Mike was a Today Show fixture of such distinctive talent that he was given virtually free rein to tell stories not about the celebrities and oddities that occupy so much of modern media, but about so-called ordinary people." Mike concentrated on the beauty of life, the importance of friendship, and the strength of family. The value of the ordinary moments that most of us, you know, just overlook and seem to take for granted. Tom Brokaw said that Mike Leonard is a national treasure. The second thing you should know about Mike Leonard is that I would not be sitting here were it not for him. And I mean that literally. And I'll share that story with you when we chat with Mike. But if you're not familiar with Mike's work or you need a quick refresher, here's what his career has been about to this moment in his own words.
I'm standing on the front porch of our home in the northern suburbs of Chicago. NBC allowed me to work from home and also gave me the freedom to do whatever story I wanted. It was my choice. And what I chose to do surprised a lot of people in the TV news business.
They were surprised because if given the choice, most reporters would opt to go where big news was breaking and not in the opposite direction, where I went, and where, when taking the time to look closely, the biggest story imaginable would come into view. The story of life. The story of who we are and what is possible when the realization hits that we are all in this together.
The best stories ever told were put in the sky. And if you really want to immortalize your heroes and the important morals of a culture and to say, you know, to the next generation who we are and what it means to be us, you put that story in the sky.
Oh, if you ain't better know by, baby, what I'm talking about.
I did over 1,000 stories during my time at NBC, learning something of value or becoming inspired by the actions of everyday people met along the way.
The real inventors don't travel the highway, they break off, make their own highway.
In my travels, I have come to realize that everybody has a story.
I love the older age because I know that my life has been a good one.
I'll see you later, Brother Randy.
Good to see you again. Nice meeting you. Nice ladies.
Hey, Max.
Everybody has insight.
I treat all customers the same.
Yep.
Respect and dignity.
We are all challenged by something. We all have obstacles to overcome.
you know, when you go to bed at night, you just thank your lucky stars of all the things that have happened. You don't say, I can't really see what missing five fingers is going to be an even trade-off for all that.
There were other big-name performers and big-time events that drew my occasional interest. The spotlight is always brighter when the rich and famous are involved. But my line of questioning always remained rooted to the same basic issues and quandaries faced by all of us. To the great world-traveling Pavarotti, I asked about the trade-off between honoring one's artistic gift and honoring one's family.
Did you ever for one moment think, gee, maybe I should stay home and forget about the profession?
It's too important. I'm sorry. It's too important. The music is really something too important. I don't want to say that I put the music before the family, but it's a decision. Then when you take this decision at the beginning, and God is so good to help you to have this kind of career, I think it would be crazy to give up for something. And then it becomes too sentimental at that precise point. I think it's really an engagement you make with the audience.
It's a dilemma for all of us who have to travel to make a living, which I have been able to somewhat soften by occasionally traveling with my family, most notably on a 2004 cross-country RV journey that included my elderly and eccentric parents. The month-long adventure was chronicled on the Today Show, which led to a best-selling book and public television series.
Everything he has, he drips coffee. I'm buying him a bib up here.
I enjoy humor, usually at my expense.
Yeah.
Mary Farrell has a farm, E-I-E-I.
Oh.
I also admire originality, even if it means trying to look and act like somebody else.
In 1990, I got the idea that we ought to link the Lincolns together.
I wouldn't have met any of these people or seen any of these places had I not purchased a Super 8 movie camera in 1969 with a desire to document life in a personal manner. Making home movies is more than a hobby for me. It's a life preserver, a way of holding on for dear life to all of those moments dear to myself, my wife, our four grown children, and nine grandchildren. Kathy and I were married in 1970 and moved from suburban Chicago to Phoenix, where I tried out for a professional hockey team after playing 4 years of Division I hockey at Providence College. I didn't make the pro team and worked a variety of jobs while the family grew and the home movie camera kept rolling. A Phoenix television executive saw a few scenes of those movies and hired me as a TV news reporter. I was 31 years old with no journalism experience. 2 years later, NBC came calling, offering a job as a network correspondent with the option of living anywhere. We chose to return to the northern suburbs of Chicago, and here we are. I am 72 years old. I have been a janitor, construction worker, hockey player, salesman, and observer of life. I am still working, still working out, still skating, still playing in our weekly front yard wiffle ball games, and still searching for more to see, more to celebrate. Why stop now when there is so much more to experience, so much more to share?
We did it. We did it again.
Joining us now from his home in suburban Chicago, aka the worldwide headquarters of Leonard Films, is Mike Leonard.
Good,
Mike, good
so
morning. How you doing today?
I'm so glad we have stayed in touch throughout all these years, too.
Yeah, I am too. You know, I value this friendship, and it's probably typical of how everybody lives. You kind of weave in and out of one another's lives, but your career has always fascinated me. You've been growing bolder for decades, and you mentioned this in the piece that we just saw, You're 31 years old. You've never worked a moment in the media, in journalism, in broadcasting, and somehow you convinced a news director to allow you to project onto his wall some Super 8 home movies, and that led, to an amazing career. What gave you the belief that you could turn those home movies into what you did?
Well, I'll shorten the story, but when I was 17, I was not a good student. I was learning disabled. I didn't know I was dyslexic at the time, but I struggled in school and they didn't test us. And so I sat in the back of the class and was basically a D student. And I stumbled whenever I read, and I didn't know, I thought that was just my problem. I didn't know it was dyslexia. I thought it was just nervousness or whatever. Anyway, when I was a junior in high school, I went to see a relatively unknown singer at an outdoor concert. And it was a young Bob Dylan. And I was so blown away by the stories and by his creativity, because he was different than anybody, that I said to myself, only to myself, that I'm going to be creative somehow, some way. And, you know, eventually still struggled in school, got into college, probably because of hockey, did okay in school after that. But I bought a movie camera because I didn't think I was a writer yet. I didn't really, and I wasn't a public speaker. I was still a little bit nervous about that. Bought a movie camera and started taking movies about everyday life. And there's only 3 minutes on the reel back then, a film. So you really had to look at things closely. And I did that. And I started looking at life like I was looking through a lens of a camera. And the one thing led to another. And I had all these other jobs. And a friend of mine in Phoenix said, who saw my home movies, said, you should do TV. And I thought, I'm not really a TV guy. I don't look like a TV guy. My nose had been broken so many times. It's been straightened since then. But I said, okay. And I, you know, it's funny because the fellow who told me, who asked me or suggested I do that was not in TV. So I went around to the TV stations and was rejected at all of them because I had no journalism experience, no education in journalism. And I just had these home movies. But the last person I saw was at public television, and he's the one who gave me a shot. Of course, it was only $40 a week with the money left over in petty cash. But as you know, Mark, when an opportunity hits, I couldn't afford not to take it. You know, we were very, very, I wouldn't say poor, but without money at the time. And a new child was born. We had three kids with no insurance. This is when that carousel comes and stops. And are you going to get on or not? And I got on, and one thing led to another. And PBS station, I was there for 3 or 4 months. And then the CBS affiliate hired me. I was a sports anchor there. And a year and a half later, Richard Salant, who was an icon of the news business working for NBC News, he was at CBS before that. I was in Phoenix vacationing and happened to turn on the hotel TV and saw me and came to the station the next day and said, how would you like to work for the Today Show or NBC News? And that was it. Then I was there for 32 years, but I was ready. You know, it was in me. And I don't think anybody in the business saw it except for the PBS man. And my friend saw it. And so I think the lesson sometimes is some people will give you advice and you don't think they have the right to give you that advice because they don't have experience. But some people know your soul, and he knew my soul, and he saw something that I hadn't seen yet. And once I saw it myself, I just believed in it.
You know, I love that story, Mike, because it is. It's about the power of encouragement, which, mm-hmm. you know, obviously I try to encourage people because you never know what they're going to end up doing. And I'm going to ask you about if you remember that single story that Richard Salant saw that changed your career. But I mentioned earlier that I wouldn't be here without you. I was a swimming coach in Phoenix in 1979 when Mike was on the CBS station there. I, like Mike, was in my 30s. I'd never even thought for a moment about a career in broadcasting or journalism, but on the 10 o'clock news, I saw a single Mike Leonard story and I was fascinated, and I watched another. And, you know, Mike, what jumped through the screen to me was first and foremost your creativity, and I am amazed, and then it was your fearlessness, because I mean, let's be honest, we've never said this, but as I watched you, I thought, you know, one night it was brilliant, and the next night it was, oh my God, did he really do that? But you could not look away. And to me, it just said, this is a man who is, you know, expressing his unique creativity and is unafraid to do it. So I called Mike on the phone. You know, this is before the internet. I called. Somehow he took the phone call. I said, "You don't know me. I'm just some swimming coach here in town. I'm amazed at what you do. I'm fascinated by how you do it." And he invited me to the station. We became friends. He helped me put together a videotape. Very quickly, I got a job in Savannah, and I was in Savannah for less than 6 months when Mike got the call from the network, and Mike called me and said, "I'm leaving town. They're moving the weekend guy into my job. The weekend position is available. You should apply for it." I did. I got the job, and you know, less than a year later, I had Mike Leonard's job at the CBS station in Phoenix. So, you know, Mike, thank you for that. But now, tell us, do you remember the single story?
Why did you take my
phone call first of all, and what was the story that Salant saw?
Well, I would always take a phone call and converse with anybody because I needed help, and I got it. So, you know, you once that happens to you, you're open to it for anybody. And I could see right away, Mark, that you had that, you know, desire to learn, and you were athletic, and you were going to go far. But the story I did, it was funny. There's a small paper called, I think it's the Mesa Tribune, Mesa, Arizona, and they had a softball team. And a guy called me one night, and he liked the stories I did. He said, we were chatting, and he said, "How's your team doing?" He said, "Oh, we haven't won a game. We're like 0-12 or something." And I thought, I'm going to do a story on them because it's all about winning usually. And here's a group of guys who are going out there and getting their butts kicked every week or twice a week. And I did this story. Let's say I filmed it on a Tuesday, and I told them I'll get on the air Thursday. And I didn't have any assistants at Cool News back then. And so it was that Thursday. And I hadn't done the story. I hadn't written the story yet or edited the story. And part of me said, "Oh, I don't have time to do it for tomorrow." But I thought, no, I told them it was going to be on Thursday. They're all going to be watching. I don't want to disappoint them. I promised them. So I said, "Heck, I'm going to do it." And I put the story together right up into the last moment. And I had their sound bites, but I wrote a rhyme. So my narration rhymed with the sound bites, and it was really different. Anyway, I just barely got it on the air. And that's the story that Richard Salant saw. So a lot of lessons there. One was, you know, I promised them that it would go on the air and it would be easier for me not to do that. And so I did it. And the other thing is I did it differently. And I never did anything differently to be different. It was just the way I was. I thought I was trying to program sports for both people who like sports and people like my wife who didn't care about sports. So they'd watch, and they did in Phoenix. They did because my stories were more about humanity. They involved sports people, but they were about, you know, about people and their lives. And so that's what Richard Salant saw. And when I went to the Today Show, they flew me to New York. And my first meeting with Steve Friedman, the boss, he was real gruff. And you know, I walked into the office there, and I'm basically, like I say, coming out of nowhere. And Tom Brokaw is the host of the show. He's in the office with this guy. And Tom Snyder, I don't know if you remember him, the late night talk show host, was there. And I'm standing outside the office and going, "Wow, I'm in a different world here." And I walked in there, and the other two said hello to me and left. And then the boss was distracted and not paying attention to what I was saying much. And I thought, man, that's one show I'll never work for is the Today Show. And ended up, he offered me the job, and he ended up being a great boss. So, you know, it's one of those things where you have that initial view of something, and a lot of times, you misunderstand it. You go, "Well, this guy's not interested in me. He was just his distracted way." And anyway, I loved my job, and I did over 1,000 stories and picked most of them. And it was a wonderful experience to see humanity and all the different forms, you know, the rich and the poor and red state and blue state. And that's where the in common thing came upon me, because I just felt that so many of us had so much in common if we didn't get into the divisive issues.
Well, I want to talk about that, but let me just kind of put a bow on what you just said, because that's the lesson that I learned from you, even though you said you weren't trying to be different. That's what got you where you were. And I learned from Mike, whenever I went to a press conference, to an event, to anything, everybody goes and does the same story. in their own voice. And I learned never do the same story, always do the opposite of what everybody else is. And I think for, you know, anybody that's out there in journalism or in the media, and let's face it, we're all in the media today. I mean, what we're doing right now on the internet, everybody is a brand. Everybody is a content producer. There are a zillion voices out there. And if you want your voice to be heard, you have to find a way to have a different take, a different angle on what you're doing. And, you know, Mike was really the first guy that did that. And, you know, and thank you for that. So you mentioned In Common, you know, which is this Emmy Award winning series that you have done. What have you learned about humanity? I mean, you named your series In Common, and, you know, what we see today is that we're so different in so many ways, to the point that, you know, it's creating all of this stress and angst and everything. What do we have in common that gives you hope that we might be able to come out of this thing okay?
Well, I'll link two things together. One was your last statement about doing things different, and then conversely, the things that make us the same. And I read a remark a long time ago that said that all of us are born originals, but most of us die as copies. Mm. And it happens early on. Like if you asked a kindergarten class who's creative there, who's an artist, they'd all put their hands up. And by the third or fourth or fifth grade, only a few will, because somebody next to them said you're not. And I think what happens is that in a sense around the country, a lot of us have become copies, and that neighbors or what they see on the media or whatever tell us how we're supposed to think, you know, whether it's politically or culturally or whatever. And it's just not the case if you strip away that desire to appeal to your friends or whatever, because really, as you know, most people haven't read up on all the issues and stuff like that. They're being told what to believe, whether it's liberal or conservative. And once you get down and talk about actually what's inside of them and what they know, we connected that way. So my stories was just about what is inside of us, the things that make us human and all the rest. You know, if I'd asked about a political issue, you know, most of the people, including myself, would just parrot something that's a tiny bit of it. But we're being manipulated, you know, and for other reasons. And I think that, you know, as I traveled around the country and without a political point of view at all, I am still friends with so many of those people in so many different places. And it was interesting because I remember I went to, I forget, I was in Georgia someplace, and a woman said, I was at the store, at the place where I was doing the story, said, well, I'm sorry, I don't know you because I don't watch NBC because I know you guys make up the news. And I said, I don't make up the news. And she said, oh, no, I know you do. You seem like a nice guy, but I know you do. I said, no, I don't, I've never made up. I know you do, but anyway, nice meeting you. And I thought something got to her, you know, I mean, and so that's one of our problems, whether I'm optimistic or not. I by nature, I'm an optimist, but I'm also a realist in that it's like raising a child. If we go too long in this situation where distrust reigns, it's like if you have a child and you don't trust the child, and the child grows up and it has a certain framework, you know, our society can come that way, and we are not immune to it. So we have to be careful, and we have to be just and kind and apolitical in many ways. I don't say you shouldn't be political, but when we want to work together, it's like if, you know, I remember reading when Reagan met Gorbachev for the Strategic Arms Limitation Treaty, they weren't getting anywhere. And it was all politics, all these advisors in the room. And Reagan went in with Gorbachev into a hotel room or a conference room and said, let me ask you a question. If aliens were attacking our planet, would you fight with me to repulse them? He said, of course I would. And that's what changed it. You know, it was just a human thing. Take the money, take the politics, take the special interests out. And, you know, we all want the same thing. And so I try to think if we could get to that point where we say, hey, we're in it together, and these threats to our culture are real, but let's solve them together. I don't want to sound like a Pollyanna guy, but I do think it's within our capability. But I also think that we have to start doing it really quickly.
Amen, Brother Mike Leonard. You know, I have to ask you a little bit about the story that you mentioned, the series that you did for the Today Show that you mentioned in that piece, The Ride of Our Lives. And, you know, really what Mike, you know, Mike, when both of my parents were ill toward the end of their life, you know, selfishly, I tried to do everything I could so I would not feel guilty after they were gone. Even though we lived on different sides of the country, you know, it's, you know, who wants to be burdened with the guilt that you didn't, you know, say what you wanted to say, do what you could have. And you know what Mike did is he took his parents and he put them in an RV and he literally took them on a final lap around the country, stopping at all of the major milestones in their lives, you know, their childhood homes, their high school, their college, you know, everything that meant that where they were married. And not only did he take his parents, he took his kids with them. And, you know, it turned into this Emmy Award winning series and a best-selling book, and you sold the film rights to Hollywood. All that said, and all that behind you, you got to feel great as a son, you know, not only for the memory you created for yourself and your kids, but what you did for your parents, because this series was at the same time poignant and hilarious. A great piece of television, but more than that, just an unbelievable gift to your parents. So kudos for you. And as you look back on that, do you regret anything about it?
Oh, no. In fact, you know, I am not the greatest human or son or whatever. I've had my time where, you know, like the phone rang and I see it's my dad. I was like, I don't have time to talk to him now. And, you know, and I didn't. I don't feel bad about that because you get busy. But what happened with that journey is it was almost like divine intervention. My dad was 87 at the time. And as I mentioned to you beforehand, that my parents never really had any money. And he was a very, very nice guy, very trusting guy. And he had moved from California back to Arizona. And he said, I want to have a place where I can walk uptown. And the realtor, you know, my dad signed the lease, but the place was isolated. And so my dad called me one night in, I think, November. And he said, hey, geez, Mike, I made a mistake. Your mom and I are just way out in the country and, you know, it's lonely here. And I felt sorry for him when I went to bed, and I had a dream or something. And I woke up and I told my wife, I have an idea. I want to get an RV. And I wasn't an RV person. And we're not campers. My parents are city people from New Jersey. And so I said, well, pick him up and go around the country. And I actually want to get another RV and take the kids, which meant one of my sons had to drop out of college. My other kids had to leave work, and it was costly. And my wife thought it was crazy. But it was just this compelling notion. And I think it was mobility. You know, when my dad said he was stuck, I wanted to get him unstuck. And that's where this RV came into mind. And then, you know, it was an adventure too. They saw things they'd never seen before, Texas and Louisiana and Mississippi. And then they went back and saw things they'd never see again. My mom and dad, I'm one of four boys, and they had a girl. Their first child was a girl who died at birth. And was buried in New London, Connecticut, when my dad was in the Navy. And I wanted to take him back to the cemetery. And I did, and found out, well, actually, I found the cemetery and didn't take him at first. And I found that the baby's, the nameplate had been lost, you know, chewed up by a lawnmower. And so I thought, this little baby that they didn't talk about much has just nothing there, and ended up getting a gravestone for it and bringing him back. But it was so rewarding, and I wasn't the hero. There were times on the journey where I was just so annoyed by them, and they were sure annoyed by me, but it was just so wonderful. And, you know, my kids got to sit and talk about life in this rolling house, you know, and, it was just beautiful. And, I, you know, after it was over, I got maybe 1,000 letters from people or more from around the country thanking me for this. And also they were telling me about their mom and dad, and they said, well, my dad drives a taxi, or my mom works in a hospital. And they weren't people of means. They were just regular people thanking me for introducing my parents, who aren't people of means, to a country and giving them a sense, like a final salute. And when my dad died, he died at 94, I think he was, at the wake, there was all these people I didn't know. And there was a teenage kid. And I said, how do you know my dad? And he said, well, I'm a part-time bag boy at the grocery store he goes to. And he's just such a nice guy. And I saw that he died. And I thought, wow, I mean, that's his money. That's his wealth. And same with my mom. And so I'm just lucky that I had parents. Also, the thing about them is, you know, we're all flawed, but they didn't get on me when I was really struggling in school. They didn't really say that I'm going to be a loser. I think they knew I was trying, but the results weren't there. And we live in a very result oriented world now. And, you know, what's your grade point average, and get that up, or you're not going to get into a certain college. And, you know, my mom and dad just thought, well, if he doesn't get in college, he'll do something. And I did get in college. I did play hockey. I did get into the TV. I lost my fear of stumbling. You mentioned earlier about, you know, doing something, being different. I think going through college and getting into college and playing hockey and being criticized and losing and all the rest and trying different things, you finally sort of feel I just have to do it. I mean, people are going to have their problems with it, but I just have to do the best I can. And I lost that, a lot of that, most of that fear of, I don't know, disappointing or being different. And so as I said before, I didn't try to be different. It was just who I was. And I'm glad I followed that path, because I don't have that face that is a natural, you know, anchor's face, or the voice that, you know, I do say and you know, and things like that. I'm not that smooth, but I try to speak from the heart, and I think I know that's the way to go.
Well, and while have you gone? You know, what an amazing conversation, Mike. Thank you so much for all you do. And folks, I hope you see the heart of the man if you haven't already. And which is why we're just so proud at Growing Bolder to be able to help him spread his message. You can look for Mike on the pages of Growing Bolder magazine and in our sixth season of our national television show, Growing Bolder, on public television stations, which is beginning to air this month. So, you know, Mike, I value your friendship more than ever, and am so grateful for what you've done for me and the lessons that you've shared with everybody else. So amen, brother. Appreciate your time.
Say that, and this is no bull. I'm really, really probably more excited to be working with you and Growing Bolder than I was getting the job at NBC, because of your mission, of what you're proposing and what you believe in, and also the character that I know you are. And you have. I think this is a great chapter, and we are just getting better. And I'm really, really honored to be a part of this team.
Well, the media is, you know, in this day and age when the media is criticized by everybody from all directions, to know that there are people like Mike Leonard still working, you know, gives us all great hope. Mike, stick around for a second if you can, and we'll say goodbye in a minute. But I'm going to kind of build myself into our meme of the week by sharing a couple of quotes. First of all, it was back in 1970 when Maggie Kuhn was working at a job with a Presbyterian church when she turned 65. And the day she turned 65, she was forced to retire because of the mandatory retirement laws back then. And shortly thereafter, she founded the Gray Panthers, which, of course, was an advocacy group to confront ageism. 88-year-old primatologist Jane Goodall says, the greatest threat to our future is nothing more than apathy. And cultural anthropologist Margaret Mead said, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has, which leads us to our meme of the week, a quote from Gloria Steinem, a journalist and leader of the American feminist movement back in the late 60s and 70s. Gloria is now 86, and she says, women grow more radical with age. One day, an army of gray-haired women may quietly take over the earth. And I, for one, don't think that would be a bad thing, which leads me to what's on my mind this morning. And it's just that. It is never too late to raise our voices. It's never too late to make a difference. Our lives are becoming increasingly nonlinear with respect to major life events. There's no longer an arbitrary age at which point we automatically transition from one life stage to another. No predetermined set of milestones that are attached to a calendar. We can go to school at any age. We can change careers. We can start new relationships. We can join the Peace Corps. We can start a business. It doesn't make any difference. In fact, I know we've talked about this before. The fastest growing group group of entrepreneurs is now women over the age of 55. So it's never too late to start a blog, to build a website, to write a book, and almost anything is possible, which is why we need guidance counselors, which is why we need role models, business incubators, and educational opportunities that are all geared toward people in their 40s through their 90s. Most importantly, we need a new belief system, which is what we talk about all the time on Growing Bolder, because when we are imagining the boundaries of what's next, we are limited by what we believe to be the boundaries of possibility. And those are being rewritten each and every day by people like Mike Leonard, who is still out there, you know, doing his best work ever. So it is not the time for any of us to wind down. It is the time for all of us to gear up for what's next. So I leave you with a revelation. Before I do that, let's bring Mike back in because I told Mike we'd say hello. Hey, Mike, thank you again.
Oh, Mark, man, I just listened to what you just said. It gives me goosebumps. I mean, you are really, really good at what you do, but also what you say is so truthful, and your voice is going to carry.
Well, you know, right back at you. It's you know, I will say this about Growing Bolder. We're authentic in what we believe, and we try really, really hard to, you know, share what we believe are the opportunities of life. And, you know, again, thank you for all you do. And I'm going to leave all of you guys now with a revelation about a revolution. We'll see you next time.
We've been riding on this longer than most. We have seen more revolutions, too. Well, here's a revolution. We are the first of a new generation. At no time in our history has the world needed us more. And there has never been a better time to stop growing older and start growing bolder. Visit growingbolder.com.
Growing Bolder, what's next?